Good morning, everyone. My name is Karen Tucker. I'm CEO of the Churchill Club. Welcome. Our program this morning is about new opportunities around innovative new cross-industry partnerships from the perspective of our guests of honor, Simon Segars of ARM and Jim Moore, former Berkman Center Fellow, an expert who has long studied cross-industry collaborations, led by Paul Saffo of Discern Analytics. Thank you all very much for being here as well. I'd also like to extend a big thank you to ARM for their partnership and their support in making this program possible, and our partners at RacePoint Group. This wouldn't have happened without RacePoint's help either. Thank you. Let's show our thanks with a round of applause. A brief introduction for our guests in the audience who are less familiar with Churchill Club. The Churchill Club is Silicon Valley's premier independent business and technology forum and has been convening unique Silicon Valley style conversations since 1985. We do this in the interest of encouraging innovation, economic growth, and societal benefit through the up to 40 programs or so that we create each year to connect people with ideas and with one another. We are a nonprofit, member-supported organization, and if you would like to join us, we would welcome you to do so. We have an outstanding set of programs coming up over the next month or so, including Massive Sensors and Data on May 15, the very popular 15th annual Top 10 Tech Trends on May 23, leading CMOs on Myths and Realities of Customer Analytics on June 4, VC Roundtable on June 6, and Digital Disruption with the leaders of Airbnb, Uber, Expensify, and Pebble on June 12. These are just some of the programs coming up, so please keep an eye on us through either the website or get yourself on our mailing list so that you know what we have on tap. If you're tweeting this morning, please use the hashtag Churchill Club, and you will find other Twitter codes in your printed programs. Our moderator, Paul Saffo, is a world-renowned and respected forecaster and leading authority on the dynamics of large-scale, long-term change. Paul is Managing Director of Discern Analytics, or Managing Director of Foresight at Discern Analytics, and he teaches at Stanford University, where he is a consulting associate professor, and he's also a visiting scholar in the Stanford MediaX Research Network. He serves on a variety of not-for-profit boards, including the Long Now Foundation,
you're using up my time.
The Bay Area Council Economic Institute, and the Churchill Club.
Yeah, in addition.
Had to get that part in there. We look forward to the conversation Paul will lead for us this morning. Please give your warmest welcome to Paul Saffo.
Great. Thank you.
Welcome to the party.
Morning, everybody. Just one thing in advance. At some point, I'm going to get a lav mic so I don't have to hold this thing. So there'll be a little technology change at some point. I am just thrilled to be on this panel as moderator, even though I am totally inappropriate as a moderator because I don't have a moderate bone in my body. But the conversation... No, it was actually... But it's been told to me many times, usually in different contexts. And so the subject here is cross-industry collaborations. And I always think about that in Silicon Valley. You know, there's some things we talk about more than we do. Ecosystems, collaboration, kumbaya, let's all get together. Sort of whenever I hear collaboration mentioned in a business context in Silicon Valley, I'm reminded who after he returned to London for the first time after he became famous, a reporter rushed up to him and said, sir, what do you think of Western civilization? And he paused and he said, actually, I think it would be a very good idea. And for the most part, I think that collaboration is honored more in the breach than in the practice. And we're extraordinarily fortunate that we have two people who actually walk their talk. So. And I'm going to ask them to briefly introduce themselves in a second, but honor formalities. Simon Segars is incoming CEO of ARM. He is currently president, and he's by Silicon Valley standards weird in another dimension. He's been at ARM since 1991. I think it was, you know, Rodney Dangerfield who said, I've been in TV so long, I've been in it since it was radio. and on the stage here with him is Jim Moore, and you have at your table a new book that just come out from Jim, Shared Purpose, 1,000 Business Ecosystems. Jim is a scholar, a visionary, an entrepreneur, and a venture capitalist, and each day it seems like he's doing a different one over and over. He's won the top award at the Harvard Business Review and is someone that I always look to as a visionary on this subject. So just one bit of context here. How many people have an arm chip on their person at this moment? That'd be everybody. Well, it'd be about 98% of you. And we talk about collaboration in the Valley, and we talk about, you know, overcoming failure and stuff. And as I was thinking about this panel late last night, I said, wait, I actually have the original ARM smartphone in my closet. And so I brought it. This is, I think there may only be two of these. This is the, you all knew the Apple Newton, which had an ARM chip. This was the Apple Newton desk phone. And not surprising, I'm sorry, I'm gonna put my mic down because I don't have my lav mic yet, but just let me just demo this thing.
So here's the desk phone. And then when you decide to go, you take the Newton off with you, and oh, by the way, you have to take the modem off. But in fact, it is a smartphone, it is an ARM chip, and it was a complete and utter failure. I think they made three of these.
Silicon Valley, because back in 91, you know, this little company, Acorn, and everybody says, well, what future could that have? And, oh, this thing tanked, and, oh, it's going to go nowhere. And, of course, we know the rest of the story. And a key part of that is because, oh, awesome, collaboration. So while I switch, I'm going to hand the floor to you, sir. Okay. Say a little bit about yourself. And your vision of collaboration. I'm going to switch mics.
All right, thanks, Paul. Morning, everyone. Thanks for getting up early and coming to this event. It's great to be here, great to be hosted by the Churchill Club. And it's great for me to participate in this and get an opportunity just to talk about some of the things we've been doing in ARM over the years and some of the challenges going forwards. The question I'm getting asked at the moment by everyone is, so Simon, you're going to become the CEO of ARM in a few months' time. What are you going to do different? What are you going to do differently from what Warren did? And it's a really easy question to answer, because when you look at the success of ARM and how we've built that over the years through collaboration and partnership, I truly believe that what has got us to this point is going to be exactly the same thing that gets us through the next set of technology challenges. And I think this morning we're going to talk about that. Some of those things. So the simple answer is, well, nothing really. You know, ARM is in a fantastic state of health. Partnership is really thriving. Yet there are a ton of challenges ahead as we look at the way technology is going to evolve, the way some of the economic issues that are challenging everyone right now. But I really believe that this open partnership model is going to be the way that we and everyone else participating in it are going to thrive. Out into the next many decades of technology. So simple answer is, I'm going to do exactly the same thing as we've been doing, because it's working really well. And you know, that's really my philosophy of how I'm going to lead ARM. So that's where I'm at.
Very nice. I'm going to hold my question. Jim, talk about open collaboration.
Sure. Well, let me start by saying that I've been interested in this topic, or the broader topic, which is how do you get organizations to solve big problems, for years. And I'm kind of an organization junkie. I love to go into big, vast organizations and be the tiniest speck on the wall and, you know, somehow start to make sense out of what's going on. And I spent the first 15 or 20 years of my career in very, very large organizations, in the AT&Ts, in organizations very, very much like Intel, but you can't say if you worked for Intel. And I saw the power of those organizations to invest large amounts of capital, I saw the power of those organizations to mobilize, you know, 10, 20, 30, 40,000 people to get something done. But I also saw how difficult they were to operate and also how inside, how vulnerable they felt. You know, you look at these things from outside and they seem very secure, but when you're in the, you know, executive suites, they don't feel it's very secure. They feel under attack from every turn. And in a way they are. They're under attack from history. So around 1999, I decided to shift over to the other side of history. I had worked with some of the larger companies on their Linux strategies and their open source strategies. I'd gotten intrigued by that. So I plunged into the world of open source, plunged into Howard Dean's campaign, was the CEO of Howard's campaign, which was a wild ride until it crashed. Got involved in a bunch of these activist things, all enabled by the web, and learned a lot about how much you can do and how little. You know, we did a year-long, very successful campaign on Darfur, although it didn't stop the horrible things that are happening there, with a $13 a month Typepad account. And Howard Dean's campaign was started, the initial months, the critical months, was done on a $25 a month hosting service website. So, you know, the power of people with a little bit of technology is unbelievable. You know, that said, you can't put $8 or $10 billion into the ground and build a fab with that model. So the last few years I've been sort of despairing, as you see, too big to fail and this kind of stuff going on, and you feel like people can't really work together to solve big problems, and yet we have bigger and bigger problems. And last fall, I get a call out of the blue from ARM, from Ali Springett, who's here somewhere, saying that they have found something about me in ecosystems. Actually, it was something I wrote about ecosystems in Africa for entrepreneurs that it tied them somehow into who I was. And they wanted an academic quality study of what they were doing to see what their ecosystem was like. And they thought it was very special. They wanted to know if it was special. Unlike a lot of these kind of things, they weren't offering a lot of money, which was and bylines and all those things to make it really legit. And I wouldn't have done it had it not been that way. So I got involved with them. And the short answer is that within weeks, I was really stunned. And we'll get to some of the things I was stunned about. But the main one was that they had a hybrid of the open source culture and the ability to throw billions of capital into the ground and do that in a meaningful way. And that right there was astounding. The other thing that was astounding for me was the ability they had to collaborate and build the power of a vertically integrated company, but without that vertical integration, through a very deep ethos of sharing and collaboration across a whole bunch of companies. So that's my, yeah.
So I have a question for both of you. But first of all, I want to show hands here, and I'm not going to call on you, so you don't feel like you need to be shy. How many people feel like they really understand the structure of ARM? Everybody who works for ARM.
I was going to say, those are the ARM people.
Yes, Ellie is very hesitantly raises her hand. She's, but to her credit, this individual's only been there for a year, so she's still trying to figure it out. So, I would like you to talk a little bit about that, but let me set this in context. Because I think about the continuum, Jim, of openness, you know, like the most closed company you can think of to, we go out probably to, occupy an anonymous at the other extreme.
Yeah.
Where is ARM along this continuum, and who are immediate neighbors to the left and to the right? And then I want Simon to talk about the ARM structure. Or do you want a moment to think about that?
No.
Answer it. Then answer it, for God's sake. We only got 45 minutes.
They're just to the left of Occupy. So at one end would be the defense contractors, and who have to wrap a lot of secrecy around what they do, and pay a big silo price for that and have to manage it. But do, there's some wonderful cross, you know, things in the military. The Navy has this advanced studies program that's wonderful at doing that kind of collaboration. So
that would be one end for me.
And the other end certainly is Occupy or Arab Spring and, you know, those kind of things, which is especially Arab Spring, especially the ones that are
so
you know.
Now I got the big scale.
Okay.
Let's
now
move in a little closer
okay,
to
all right,
arms
okay
neighborhood.
To the more structured side is the obvious intel and the intel generation of ecosystems, the sort of more centrally orchestrated ecosystems that had a task to solve that was a task of 20 years ago, which was how to align the people we can just get together to make this thing whole, and then how do we keep it going? So I'd say that's the one side. To the other side are the open source communities that eschew property rights and that really work in a dedicated way to avoid conventional finance. And so you take Yochai Benkler,
Creative
Harvard.
Commons.
Yeah, Creative Commons. Yochai's work. Yochai has a course at Harvard Law School on non-financial motivators, and so that would be there. And in the middle here is a company that is pragmatic rather than ideological, but accepted by kind of all sides, and in a way is teaching all sides the benefit of collaboration and the benefit of investment, particularly when it comes to hardware versus software. So.
Well, I think that's a really key takeaway, that phrase, pragmatic, not ideological, is a key to success. I'm going to come back to you more on this, because I think we can refine it more. I imagine Google is, you know, serving the neighborhood. By the way, I finally understood Facebook the other day. A friend of mine was saying, you know, Google is the graduate program you always wanted to go to. You know, get on that campus, it feels exactly like that. And I finally realized what Facebook is. It's the undergraduate program you always wanted to go to. So, Simon, describe ARM to these folks in terms of the collaboration and the feel of the culture and how you work with your partners.
Okay. Well, I think all of that ethos we have day to day really does come from the way in which the company was founded. Yeah, it was a spin-out of some technology that had come from a British computer company. It was a joint venture initially with Apple and VLSI Technology and Acorn Computers, which was this British computer company. And there were 12 guys, 12 engineers spun out of the team in Acorn. They got set up in a converted farm building in the middle of the Cambridgeshire countryside, which sounds pretty rough, but it was actually a very nice building, oak beams, and it was hundreds of years old, and it was a lovely setting. There was no air conditioning.
In the fans with the fog.
In the fans, yeah, the fog, and in the summer, all these insects used to fly through the windows, and you'd shut the windows, and then you'd get too hot.
Beer in Grantchester, yes.
Yep, and yeah, beer, a big part of the original culture. You know, we'd all go down the pub on a Friday, and the last man out locked the door. So very, very collegiate way of working. And you know, when you look at the way the company was started, it was almost nonsensical that we're going to take this processor technology and start licensing it to people who mainly had microprocessor technology of their own and encourage them to stop doing what they were doing and integrate our processor technology into these chips. And a lot of people kind of looked at that and thought, you know, you are crazy. This is never going to work. Why would you ever persuade people to stop doing it themselves and outsource this key differentiating technology?
I mean, I really did have that sense of Douglas Adams meets Monty Python.
Many analogies like that have been made over the years. Funny walks. Our first CEO used to do a great Chinese impression, which I won't repeat for you. You'll be glad to know. But I think what was going on at the time was technology was getting to the point where you could start building systems on chip, SoCs. You could start integrating building blocks into more and more sophisticated devices, and a processor didn't have to be a standalone chip on a circuit board. It could be integrated with other things around it. And so process technology was allowing that. And also, at the same time, you had rising costs going on quite severely. The cost of supporting a processor architecture was very large. When you look at how much it takes to both keep the processor technology itself going, and then all the software and everything else you need to actually make that process useful, you know, that was on a cost trend that was only going in one direction. So, you know, we actually found a fairly receptive audience, and it certainly took some work of going around and talking to lots of people before the model really took off. But these technology trends were all helping. So one of the other things that was in Arm's favor at the time was, you know, we were a bunch of guys, and I joined the company a few months after it got started, a bunch of guys in the middle of the Cambridge countryside with no customers nearby. We had some contracts to fulfill from Acorn just up the road, but any other customer we wanted to talk to was a plane ride away. And it was either in California, or it was in Japan, or it was in Korea, you know, somewhere in Asia. It was a long way away. So we were kind of almost lucky that we didn't have a big potential customer base on our doorstep, because it forced us to think about global trends, where's technology going, who are the companies that we need to go and license, and where is their technology going to be used. So it forced us to think about supply chains and also ecosystems. So the other thing I think going for us was the fact that it was, by the time I joined, 16 people who had no chance on earth of replicating everything that was being done in very large semiconductor companies, because we just didn't have anything like the scale or the resources. You know, we had a very small amount of funding. It was very important that we closed some deals to get some new funding in the form of revenue. And so Robin Saxby, who was our founding CEO, you know, would say to us, you know, we cannot do everything. We're going to have to build up a partnership, a network of companies who can do all of those other things around this processor technology to make it actually useful. And that, you know, turned out to be a fairly inspirational thought, because as we went out and built this partner network with a view that, you know, we're not going to do everything ourselves, and that in order to get other people to do some of this work, that had to be a profitable business in its own right for them. You know, it's easy to look at Arm as this big kind of friendly, cuddly organization that sings kumbaya around the campfire, but you know, we are a profitable business. We are in business on behalf of our shareholders to make money, and we believe that the partnership that that we work with also ought to be thinking like that. They also ought to be able to have profitable businesses, and in fact, the only way to make it really sustainable is if everybody does make money out of that.
I just want to note, I didn't mean to imply you all sang kumbaya. Okay. I assume.
I don't even know all the words.
I mean, I still remember some of the Cambridge drinking songs, but you know,
talk about initial conditions. I want to get to Arm today, but initial conditions really matter. Mm-hmm. I mean, where you all came from has gotten you to where you are. A lot of companies now are just getting hip to the idea of collaboration, but they struggle with it because I think it's not in their DNA. So can a company that was initially not collaborative, didn't have this kind of feel that, you know, the origins you have, can they do a pivot and learn to collaborate across industries and change their internal structure to do that?
I think it probably depends on how they are perceived by the rest of the industry. So if you're a company that's perceived as having done it all yourself because you could, then you probably can build an ecosystem. If you're a company that's perceived as you've done it all yourself and you've, I don't know, exploited people around you in order to generate your success, I think that's going to be a lot more difficult.
I don't know why, I just had this image in my head of Steve Ballmer singing Kumbaya. So take us a little forward to the Arm culture today. How does that collaboration express itself inside the company?
Well, I mean, I think one of the things that's really interesting about Arm as you go around is this sense of how the entire ecosystem does support, you know, is mutually supporting itself. That didn't come out right, you know what I mean. We're doing stuff, our partners are doing stuff, and it's all very collaborative, and everybody is benefiting as a result. So our employees are very aware of, you know, the fact we're working with semiconductor companies who we license. We're working with software companies, operating system companies, EDA companies, people providing design-in services. There is this huge ecosystem, and it's a constant source of discussion in the company. And as we look into the markets in which we're designed, there is a constant conversation about the supply chain, the ecosystem that makes this particular vertical market successful. And therefore, what do we need to do? Who do we need to engage with up and down the supply chain? We're not just thinking about who we sell to. We are thinking about what it takes to make a particular product successful in the market. and therefore, who do we need to go and learn from? And from the very early days, we set out to not just talk to our customers, but talk to our customers' customers and their suppliers, just to try and learn as much as we could about particular vertical markets, so that the technology we built was going to be the right technology, or we were giving ourselves as great a chance as possible to design the right thing, acknowledging that it won't actually go into production for many, many years' time. So what do we need to do? Who do we need to go collaborate with to make this successful in a particular vertical? And those ecosystems are all different. The people that do software work in the automotive industry is very different from those that do software work for mobile phones. There's a lot of overlap going on now, but there are different specialisms, so you have to understand that.
And, you know, I think this is a fascinating time for you to be taking the reins of the company. That ARM's been extraordinarily successful because of this model. And yet we all know what it's like to live in a Schumpeterian world. And you all are seeing a couple of changes on the horizon. I mean, obviously in the press, you know, at some point I'm sure we'll come up to some chip issues. But the big one I see on your horizon is that you're running out of people to sell chips to. And so that means you're going to have to sell chips to machines. So going from, you know, communications world to the Internet of Things and sensors and all that, is that the next big horizon for ARM?
Well, it's one of them. I mean, in terms of, if you look at the volume of chips containing ARM processors sold relative to the population of the Earth, you know, we sell more chips, well, our partners sell more chips than there are people. But, you know, there is different levels of concentration. And I think there's a huge scope ahead of us for more people on the planet to benefit from modern technology. You look at smartphones, for example. There's only about a billion or so of those deployed around the world. So that's actually, you know, fairly small compared to all the people on the planet. There is a huge opportunity and huge benefits that will be had by having much lower cost devices in the hands of, you know, the other 6 or 7 billion people that are out there. So, yeah, in terms of just the volumes of the businesses that ARM's more conventionally associated with, I think there's huge growth potential there.
But my hunch is that you're going to be facing more transformations in the company under your tenure than, and in fact, I'll ask Jim, I won't even ask you. He's going to be facing more transformations in his tenure than his predecessor, no?
Yeah, I think if you talk to people in ARM about what they're concerned about, where it's going, I think they think the fundamental model is sound, the model of, you know, continuing to search for pain, continuing to search for issues you can solve, and assembling sort of ecological communities around that going after. So that continues, I think. The issue is scaling that in a world where Charlene Marini, one of their execs, calls these increasingly complex spheres of influence. So you go into healthcare, right? And then healthcare splits into, you know, biomems and that whole sensor kind of world, you know, and related to that, ingestible and implantable and, you know, that stuff. Then over here, there's systems of pumps and, you know, and in hospitals, whole different thing, licensed in a different way, you know, and then there's diagnostics that aren't licensed. So in each of these verticals, there's increasing complexity, and the promise of the technology, there is a sort of a Moore's Law thing in here, which is a little different than we normally think of it. The promise of the technology as you get to the atomic level lets you engineer things that are really amazing. And that's how you get ingestible little computers that have radios. But it also means that way back here, where you're working with the fabs, you probably have to be collaborating all the way up the chain to make that thing. So I think that it's the human knowledge network limits that they're heading into, as well as geographic as they get to wider and wider GI. That's where I would see the vulnerability.
So sticking with you for a second, Jim, that it seems like there are two companies out there have one of two challenges. They're either, they haven't done so well with cross-industry collaboration in the past, and now with example of successes like ARM, they realize they got to get with it and start doing that. That's a tough challenge. Mm-hmm. And we can all instantly think of companies who are going to have a hard time with that. The second challenge is more subtle, and that is companies who've been very successful with collaboration now have to keep transforming themselves because collaboration itself is a moving target, mm-hmm. correct?
Yeah.
Say, how, you know, in a way that's harder. Well, we've done great with collaboration so far. How do we keep pushing it forward? And if you'd answer that in the general, then I want Simon to talk about it in the specific. How do you keep transforming?
Yeah. Well, part of what's happening is the products themselves are helping with that, right? So collaboration is about something, and it's over something. I mean, networks that connect us and let us talk with each other enable us to collaborate. Networks that let us talk to each other about masses of data being pulled in real time makes that, you know, more powerful. So I think part of this is continuing to write and integrate the technology that we're pushing out. The Moore's Law-ish thing we're going to get to, though, is the incredible complexity and fragmentation of science itself. And the world problems it's up against. I mean, my view looking at the last few years is that just science is, you know, everything's exploding, right? We didn't think neuroplasticity was real until the last, decade. That's true in all these different fields. And then we also didn't see out ahead all these sort of calamitous things. And so I think it's how do we up collaboration to the point where we can tackle really big things? I mean, these guys are tackling something really big, but it's not yet really, really big. You know, it's not agriculture, it's not climate change, it's not, you know, healthcare.
I think what he's saying, Simon, is what have you done lately?
No.
So I mean I think fortunately with the growth of the internet, I think people are used to being a lot more open and sharing. You know, when ARM started, you know, the internet existed, email was pretty much the only thing you did with it. And you know, the internet was not designed for the main uses to which it's put today. Fortunately, though, business models and sharing and openness have exploded and have been enabled by the internet. So people we recruit today don't use email much. They're used to using much more social media type applications to share information with each other. So fortunately, as some of this complexity goes up and the need to collaborate more increases, the people who are coming into these industries are much more used to that as just their day-to-day working lives. They're much more open to sharing stuff and collaborating with each other. You know, we look at the way, you know, my daughter is in the middle of high school right now, works with her friends on a joint project versus what I had to do when I was at school. It's very, very different, and it's technology that's making that happen. So I think a lot of things going on right now are self-reinforcing about the way in which people are going to just approach work conveniently is well matched to how they're going to have to operate at work to solve some of these problems.
I love that context. Now, talk about the partners in your ecosystem. How do you tend to the partners in the ecosystem? And how do you make sure they all get their fair share and are happy?
Well, we're really nice people, you know.
That's really true. I mean, that's...
Yeah. And you can trust us.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's true, by the way.
Thank you very much. It takes work. So, you know, we have...
practical tips.
Practical jokes. Well, in trying to ensure that as many people as we possibly can get real face-to-face interaction with our customers. So very few people are sat at their desks, you know, typing away or drawing layouts or doing whatever they're doing without some sense of the thing I'm doing is going to end up in the hands of a customer and it's going to end up in a product. So, you know, we talk about that a lot internally, and the project teams working on our product developments are working with lead customers. So since the very early days of ARM, we've had this model of we're not just going to sit in the back room and have deep thoughts because we're really smart and build something and hopefully we will be able to sell it. We have always worked very closely with people who want to be very aggressively first into a market or, you know, go into the next generation. And by working with them and often with working with their customer as well, the people doing the work have got a real sense of I'm doing this and I can see where it's going. And so that exposes them to the supply chain of what's going on and the urgency about the work they're doing. And that really helps.
So with the people at ARM, do you have to hire people with that in mind? Are you looking for that personality at the moment of hire, or can you teach, I think of the old joke that in Silicon Valley, how do you tell an extroverted engineer? They look at your shoes. can this be taught, or do you hire for it?
A bit of both. We do hire a lot of graduates in from universities, and you are looking for raw intellect, some degree of personality, and with a view to steeping them in the company's culture. The junior levels, that's what we're doing. And the more senior levels, we're absolutely looking to hire people who are open in their thinking and are going to be able to build partnerships.
So I know where I see this in the academic environment with business school. So I teach at a small university down the road, and our business school, it's pretty explicit in their application process. They're looking for people who are socially interactive. And I think of the business school grads, back in the late 80s, when you were just heading towards ARM to today. Back then, the business school grads were really smart, but some of them were, just didn't have social skills. Mm-hmm. And now, the business school students are all wicked smart, and they know how to throw great parties. And it's sort of like a requirement to do business school. And I think this is business school responding to this cross-industry collaboration. Mm-hmm. Are you seeing that kind of deep change with your employees?
Well, I think, as I said, the growth of technologies such as Facebook mean that the people who are coming out of university are used to operating in this, they're sharing constantly.
So
there is definitely that trend. One of the things that gets mentioned in the book there is a comment that Ian there made when talking to Jim about the way we assess people annually. We have a formal process like any big company would, or any company would do. And teamwork, sharing, creativity, these are the kind of metrics. Funny walks, looking at somebody else's shoes. These are the way in which we judge people. These are the ARM core values that we look for. So that is, everybody knows that. Everybody knows that's how they're being measured. Therefore, if you're a hiring manager, that's kind of built into what you're looking for when you're actually going to recruit somebody.
You reduce the ARM core values down to a haiku or something slightly longer than haiku. How would you express that for everyone here?
I think quite simply put, it is about teamwork and collaboration. That's what we measure people on, one of the things we measure people on, but I'd say it's probably the most useful feature. We look for people to collaborate internally. The people who are good at it tend to be the people who progress within the company.
Good. Let's go to some questions here. And as people are thinking about their thoughts, just, Jim, I'm going to come back to both of you on this. Imagine a chart where my y-axis is degree of openness. Mm-hmm. We've talked about that. And then my x-axis is the nature of the challenge, the size of the challenge, or the like. And I don't quite have the x-axis mm-hmm. dimension set, mm-hmm. but we're in a moment in time where we're surrounded by exponentials. I mean, there's the exponential of Moore's law. We take that for granted. But there are also the exponentials of the global challenges facing us all. Okay. And if I pull back to the really big picture here, why we're sitting here over breakfast, is it's that this whole notion of open collaboration and ecosystems is how we're going to solve our global challenges. And I mention that now because I'd like to come back to that at the very close of this conversation. So think about it. Questions? Oh, right up here. And say who you are, sir. We'll get this wireless technology. It's only been around 100 years. We'll get it right eventually.
So the question I have is, it seems like if I think about the long-term secular advantage you have, the axis is power consumption and cost. And as you think about some of these big opportunities and the buckets of people untouched out there, The couple things popped to mind. Africa is an emerging market. Certainly, you still have a lot of opportunities within the Asian region and South and Latin, Central America. So as you think about reaching that paradigm, combined with the flip side, which is increased server concentration for data farms in the cloud, is there a meet point where the two come together? Or are those two very, very different approaches to attacking growth opportunities?
Well, I think you mentioned that the power consumption and cost are key advantages for us. And from a technology point of view, that is true. You know, technology enables low power. Technology enables very small die size of what we build, and that helps with cost. But that technology on its own is not enough. It is the business model that really helps make that technology useful. And I think the combination of the technology, the business model, are going to help with addressing all of those challenges that you said. You know, I think the one big thing that is going to drive a lot of technology is just the growth of data. So I talked a moment ago about smartphones and huge potential for that in developing countries. And there are real examples happening now, and there'll be more of them in the future, where access to that technology, because it is cheap, is helping people's lives improve. Whether it's the bolt-on sonogram, whether it's getting real-time access to data which allows somebody to actually understand what it is, the thing they've just grown, what it is actually worth, and not get fleeced by various middlemen along the way. All those things are making people's lives better. And the cheaper you can make it, the more prevalent it will become, the better that is. It's going to generate a lot of data. It's going to consume a lot of data. Internet of Things, we haven't really gone into that today, but that's another one where there's going to be a lot of data. That's going to drive more requirement in the cloud, going to drive more requirement in the network that moves the data between these endpoints. Turns out that coupled with that, power consumption will go up. So the technology benefits of low power, low cost are going to help all of that. But being able to deploy it through a wide network and have the support infrastructure to make those key bits of technology really usable, it's that business model that really helps those technologies become deployed.
Over here. And tell us who you are.
Sure. I'm Mike Demler with the Lindley Group. Simon, I'm wondering, when you look at a collaborative model for the ecosystem, how do you balance collaboration versus acquisition? We see EDA companies buying IP companies. Do you think that the ecosystem that you're in, semiconductor design enablement, is going to become more aggregated or less?
That's a good question. I don't know where the right trade-off is between more aggregation or less, but I do know that the complexity of what people are building is going up and up and up, and some of the key building blocks that people are putting in the chips are becoming very sophisticated, and as good a job as we do in trying to create very clean interfaces so things can plug and play, still the task, of building a complex SoC and having it work is getting harder and harder. So a lot of that is driving some of the acquisitions that we see going on, because IP and tools and have all got to work very well together. And if you're building an SoC, given just the table stakes of doing that, you don't really want to deal with 300 suppliers who, when it all goes wrong, can kind of point the fingers at the other guy. So that does drive. I think some of the M&A that you see going on is enabling solving these problems to remain tractable, actually. But I think we're going to see new technologies come along. We will see new companies addressing those problems. So there'll be a kind of constant evolution of companies and technologies.
I'd like to make a quick response on that one, because I've just been recently talking to the EDA executives about this, and they do talk about it. And I guess the thing I found fascinating in the whole this whole community is how alert people are to industry structure effects, to concentration, to distribution, to what it means if that guy's buying those three companies and they happen to have complementary technology and now they're going to have a little lock here, and what does that mean? And what I was surprised to see was
there's a kind of tension people are actively managing, and they're managing it, you know, to the extent that they sort of legally can as a community. So the tension is, on the one hand, it's easier to integrate some things. On the other hand, that gives me a lot less flexibility. So I like, you know, I like the more flexibility. And then the thing I'm concerned about on the other guy is that he's going to integrate something and then extort a high price from me for that, or extort something from, you know, get TSMC to block me out. There's this kind of second level where people are gaming this. But the overall value, which I find interesting, is generally of the benefits of open collaboration to the point you can break it, and then integration by the systems themselves. So they'll always start by telling you that there are hundreds and hundreds of IP little mom and pops out there that are being run through qualifying systems and then integrated in.
So Simon, I want to pursue this just a little further. Again, thinking of that continuum of openness and collaboration, they're the things way off to the right that, like, nobody's in charge and all that. I mean, this is a collaboration environment where there, I mean, in charge isn't quite the right word, but there is a central node. And there obviously are times when various partners may be happy with ARM, but not happy with each other. Mm-hmm. And as an executive, how do you handle that?
Well, it is an interesting challenge that.
Yes,
you
know, but how do you handle?
We bring our partners together, and you know, we're totally aware that, you know, they're in business to put each other.
So
out
is this like
business.
Rodney King? Can we all just get along?
what we tend to see is that. What we are doing is providing some technology that doesn't differentiate our customers' end products. So, you know, if you go and buy a washing machine, you don't care what microprocessor is in there. If you go and buy...
Please just don't let it run Windows.
That's not up to me.
I mean, Windows 8.
Windows 8 is so great for washing machines.
I do love Windows, in fact.
But that's the great thing, that is not up to ARM, right? We are providing some technology, we are working with our partners to license that and make it usable, and they are, in the main, happy to come and share with us enough so that thing can be good. They know
so
it doesn't differentiate
them. So you don't
them,
get caught in the middle of those conflicts very often?
Occasionally. I mean, good. We have to be very sensitive to honoring the confidential information our partners are telling us. Right. We have to be very careful with IP that we get from other people that we need to have to work with to make our product useful. But we have established a level of trust over the 22 years we've been in business and ways of working so that people do trust us to do that and feel comfortable that we're not going
to
leak their
information.
So
that to me feels
like
a key takeaway from the pragmatics of ARM, that you have to create a structure where you have collaboration, but when there's conflict, that the conflict doesn't roll back up into you guys. It gets sorted out on the outside.
Yeah, and that does come through trust. And you know, saying trust me is easy. It's about, you know, the actions backing up the words. And we have been doing this for a long time and built those trusting relationships through our ecosystem that it works. Can you put your finger on what exactly it is? Well, not really. It is.
But you know
slightly
what you see
nebulous.
Is. Yeah. Good. Let's get a couple more questions. Okay. I think we have a little less than 10 minutes left here. So. They always shine
over
bright
here.
Lights in ours. There we go.
Yeah.
Sir, who are you?
I'm Steve Eliscu with UBS. I wanted to ask a question about wearable computing. We talked about IoT, Internet of Things, as one of the next big trends. I think the whole thing with Google Glass has really sparked a lot of interest. This is the biggest thing since the iPhone in 2007. So particularly for Simon, just trying to understand in terms of the thing that must keep you up at, one of the things that must keep you up at night is how does ARM succeed in the post-smartphone era? I know we're just getting used to the post-PC era, but clearly as we look to smartphones with 1080p displays and quad-core processors, yeah, they will incrementally get better. But it almost seems like we're getting to the point where you don't necessarily need to get a new PC every 2-3 years, and we may get to that point soon with these mobile devices. So in terms of thinking about the enablement that ARM needs to do, how do you think about making sure that ARM is positioned for the next big set of trends, specifically when you think about high-end client computing? Wearable clearly looks like it could be one of the next big things, both for ARM itself as well as the ecosystem. What are the key things that you think that need to be enabled to make that happen?
So I think in terms of the post-smartphone era, I mean, I understand where you're going with, have you got enough compute performance? PCs plateaued, therefore smartphones will plateau. That's the kind of theory I hear from a lot of people. I think what's interesting about smartphones and tablets, in contrast to PCs, is the fact that there are so many people working to create the technology as opposed to PCs, which, frankly, let's face it, were controlled by two people. There's a much more open network of companies and individuals innovating around this platform. So what you do on a PC today is basically what you did on a PC 10, 15 years ago. What you do on your phone today is very different from what you did 2 or 3 years ago. And I think there is big scope for the phone controlling and interacting with other devices. And the great thing about them being so open is the fact that, you know, some guy in his bedroom can create some killer app and think of a way to use the technology that's in the phone in a way that the guys who designed it in the first place weren't even contemplating. So I think we're a long way from hitting the plateau of ingenuity around this platform because it's so open. So that kind of allows me to sleep a little easier. The other thing that allows me to sleep easy is the fact that the demand for semiconductors is only going up. Wearable computers is one example of Internet of Things applications, and we're starting to see, you know, some of that coming through. Fitbits, Nike Fuel Bands, things like that are starting to become more commonplace, especially here in Silicon Valley. And I think that is a growing trend. I think we will see sensors built into your clothes and all over the place generating information. What's interesting about that is what you're going to do with the data, how you're going to turn it into real information, and how you're going to share that. And you know, when you look at, say, your Bluetooth-connected bathroom scales that you can weigh yourself on every day and get a nice little graph on your phone, and your Nike Fuel Band, which tells you how inactive you are in the day, and gives you a nice little graph on your phone. These are completely closed systems right now. It would be really handy if you could correlate activity to weight loss. Now, that should be a fairly simple thing to get your head around. But you know, to be able to see how what you did has had real impact in other ways would be really handy. So if the data was more open, then again, you can have people innovate around these platforms. But it raises a whole load of issues about security and privacy and authentication of devices. So it'd be great if I could say to my healthcare, you know, my health insurance company, give me a cheaper rate because look, I am active and look at the benefits it's having on my blood pressure and my weight, you know, all of which is being monitored constantly. But it's pretty terrifying to think that that might get abused by somebody else. And if you're the insurance company, you want to know that it's Simon standing on the scales in the morning and not somebody else. So a whole bunch of issues there, which if we can solve, I think will open up a lot more technology. Like I said at the beginning, the internet is being used in ways that people didn't first think of. And that's been allowed to happen because it's an open. There are lots of open standards. And businesses big businesses have been built up around this infrastructure that is there. And I kind of see the Internet of Things evolving in a similar way. There's going to be an infrastructure, lots of sensors, lots of data flowing around. And there is an opportunity for services and businesses to be built on top of that once it's deployed. But right now, what everyone's doing, and there's some great examples, are closed systems. And I think where we obviously want as many ARM processors deployed through that as possible. But I think we've got a great opportunity through our business model, through the way in which we build networks, business networks, to work on some of those big issues that are going to allow the IoT to become a safe but open platform where people can really start to exploit this hardware that can become ubiquitous in the same way that the internet has.
Can I have a show of hands of everybody who would like to ask a question? Raise your hands. One, two. One, two. None over here. Two questions. So let's put a mic to you, and then we'll get both questions, and we'll answer them together.
Hi, I'm Ricardo Spina. Ricardo Spina from SAP. So I have a question regarding corporate culture. One of the comments that you discussed was...
I don't think the audience can hear you. Let's get a new mic to you.
Sorry.
Is there an arm chip in that mic? Yeah, that sounds like...
Just hold it really close.
This is good. Okay.
So I have a question about your corporate culture. You mentioned all of your different virtues as collaboration and creativity. One of the principles that I see in engineering culture is the concept of personal intellectual property. So I'm curious if you have any insights that you could share on how you break those barriers down and create or drive collaboration between engineering teams or engineers when there's that notion of personal intellectual property being developed.
Let's get the second question here.
Okay. So Mark Plake is from Orange. I'm not sure this fits very well with that question.
That's
but,
my problem, not yours.
it seems like there's this theme of phone to cloud. And, you know, when you think about the work you're doing with open compute and the data center space, I mean, are you getting to a point in conversations where you're painting a picture of end-to-end ARM at the smartphone end all the way back to the data center because you keep talking about big data?
Okay. Maybe
take the second first.
Take the second first. So I think there is absolutely the potential for ARM technology end-to-end from the sensor, the smartphone, through the network, into the data center. You know, we're starting to see early deployments of ARM in the data center. We're starting to see early deployments of ARM into enterprise-level networking and obviously in sensors. So absolutely. And I think that from a technology point of view, and again from a business model point of view, there is the opportunity to deploy ARM processors in a big way through that. And lower the power, which I think is going to be actually a necessity before this big network that we can kind of visualize can actually become a reality.
Jim, would you take that first question? You've been looking across a whole bunch of companies, and you know, what's the secret sauce to collaboration inside?
Well, there are a couple ones. The easy one, and I'll quote George Lees from Freescale. Used to spend, and they make a whole range of microcontrollers out of Austin and a bunch of fabs all over. And George said his software cost for software engineering used to be about 40% to 50% supporting multiple processor architectures. So by standardizing on one, and he said, you know, it could have been a bunch of them. For other reasons, they standardized on ARM for the software and the ecosystem and so forth. But for technological reasons, they could have gone different ways. But standardizing on one knocked down 30 or 40% of his engineering costs and stuff engineers didn't really want to do. He said the next thing that's happened is with open source and open collaboration, my engineers don't solve things in the corner anymore. They get online and they start sharing code. Now that may be a generational thing, you know, that I don't know how you get people who haven't been doing that, who've been doing it in the corner and like the stuff they got, how they get them to loosen up. But the new engineers do like that, and again, it's a lot because the mundane stuff gets done for them. Okay, it's like I need a driver, I need this. Let me grab it. Okay, so here's the really amazing thing. More and more, and he's actually got measures. This more and more of the engineering time is going to things that differentiate, and the more that happens, he's selling chips to a lot of people. The more that happens, the more collaboration they're willing to do here because they recognize how little value it adds relative to what they're doing up here. So the entire system is moving faster into differentiation. And he happens to be in, you know, automobile and, you know, voice recognition and vision and so forth and, you know, really interesting stuff. So I think that's the short answer. The other quick one, which I would like to get in because we talked about it earlier, is this issue of just enough. I think the most radical thing about this organization is that these guys don't actually take as much money off the table as they could. You don't hear in their company culture lock in and, you know, which is, you know, a guy locked in, and you don't hear increasing returns used about increasing profitability. What you hear is, in some sense, is increasing returns to proliferation. So they're making a choice. They're making a choice. That's sort of the Walmart, if you will. They're making a choice to proliferate and lower costs as much as they can and be everywhere. And they're not taking the profits out now. You know, that said, the growth is amazing, the diversity of things they can touch is amazing, their cost structure is amazing. And again, that's why I think they are the disruptive technology here is this organization, where people are willing to take less in favor of growth, they're willing to share in favor of differentiation. It's
And good, so I have one last question, but let me ask permission from my boss. Can I ask one more question? Should we just call it? We can just quit now. Jim, that's a perfect place to pick up on, because you know, when I think of the specific example of ARM and then the more general example of collaboration in the technology space has led to all sorts of wonderful surprises, and it's also helped, let's face it, tackle some important issues. The Kenyan farmer who can now get a fair price for his product because he has a smartphone that that works in the environment he's in. But there are lots of much bigger challenges out there. It's not ARM's business to tackle them necessarily, but we know there are bigger unmet challenges, some of which are exponentially growing challenges. Simon, based on your experience at ARM, and Jim, based on your experience looking across collaboration at this industry level, what are the insights, if sitting here with you was Ban Ki-moon and a couple of heads of state and some activists, what are the insights you pull out of what's happening with collaboration in this industry that you would apply to the bigger challenges? Either one.
Well, I think, as you say, there are some big issues that ARM is not going to solve. Energy issues, growth of population.
World peace in your first
world peace, all of that. Now, we're not going to solve those problems, but I think technology has a huge role to play in solving those issues. And being able to easily and quickly and with low cost deploy technology, that has to be the way to go forward. And I think our model accelerates that.
Yeah, the model. Because as Jim said, the really remarkable thing about you is the model.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think we've got some great technology, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But it's being able to deploy it in a massive way and enable people to innovate around and not waste their time reinventing the wheel, which is kind of the point you were making, and do it in a way that is cost effective through the whole supply chain, enables more technology to get deployed sooner. And if you can do that in a way that that is respectful of everyone through the supply chain, then this will continue to be successful. And I think that is going to help solve some of these big problems.
Okay. Jim, last word.
We haven't talked about the powerful gatekeepers that stand before some of these big troubled areas. There are people who have immense access to healthcare as a market, and they're gatekeepers. And if those people can be flipped, if you will, to demand more than they're getting today, and to demand what we know we can do, I think things change rather rapidly. And I want to give an example of Frank Frankowski at Facebook, who was one of my all my interviewees were my favorites. I love them, but Frank was a particularly fun favorite. Bearded guy, lives in the Southwest, and comes up here once in a while, and goes in bars, and he's a great guy. So, but he's sitting there getting ready to buy, many, many billions of dollars of serving, let's call it, okay? And as he's buying that serving, he doesn't want to keep buying what he's buying. So he has said no. But he said no more of this stuff. But he's not just saying no more at this cost or this power. He's saying no more of the process you guys are using. He's saying, I want an ecological process from it. And he's got Intel collaborating with Calzada, with PMCC. And he's got them doing it. He's got them sharing intellectual property. He's got them doing the same stuff. And I think that's part of it too. There are powerful people on the other side as customer reps who can ask for the process.
Yeah, and what's really interesting about that is it would be easy, if you're Frank, to take the hard-nosed purchaser solution to this problem and just go, make it cheaper, make it cheaper, make it cheaper. Mm-hmm. But he isn't doing that. Mm-hmm. He's saying, the problem I'm trying to solve is this. Mm-hmm. Come up with your best solution to this problem, and then I'll probably buy your product. Mm-hmm. But please innovate.
On that note, thank you, gentlemen. Let's thank give our guests a hand. Thank you.
Simon, Jim, Paul, thank you so much, Paul, for leading this discussion, and Simon and Jim for sharing your perspectives with us so freely. If there were aspects of this topic that you would like to hear that we didn't have time for this morning, we encourage you to reply to the audience survey that we will send out later today, and we'll pass that input back to our speakers as well. As a humble token of our appreciation, we have for you this morning the Churchill Club speaker t-shirt.
Speaker t-shirt.
Thank you very much.
Please.
It's the only way to get one, right?
Please wear it in good health. A recording of this program will appear on the Churchill Club YouTube channel within the next day or so. Thank you again to Arm and Racepoint, and you have been a wonderful audience. Thank you so much. Have a great day.